Back in 2001, GM wanted to offer an alternative to their popular Duramax engine. They needed something mean, they needed something lean, and they needed something powered by gasoline. What's up, guys? My name is Bryce with Dust Runners Automotive Journal, and today I'm going to tell you everything you need to know about the Vortec 8100. The idea of a gasoline alternative to a diesel engine is definitely not new and is definitely not exclusive to GM. Before diesel engines became so popular in light-duty trucks, the 454 Big Block was the normal for 2500 or 3500 truck. If you love GM trucks, need something heavy-duty, but don't want to have to deal with finding diesel every time you need to go fill up, then the Vortec 8100 is for you. Although most people would rather have the Duramax engine, there were enough people who wanted a gasoline alternative at the time that GM decided to make it happen. Basically, they took the crankcase of the old 454 Big Block and gave it even more stroke. Officially, the Vortec 8100 is not recognized as the Gen 7 Big Block, although it shares so many things with the Gen 6 Big Block that most people just consider it the Gen 7, even though GM does not. What makes the Vortec 8100 more powerful than any big block before it is mostly the displacement. I mean, 496 cubic inches is a lot. It also has better cylinder heads and slightly improved electronics. The resulting output is 340 horsepower and 450 foot-pounds of torque, which is pretty good considering the outgoing 454 had 290 horsepower and 410 foot-pounds of torque. There were variants of the Vortec 8100 that had upwards of 500 horsepower, but those were not used in the light-duty trucks, where the Vortec 8100 is most known for. This engine is available in GM 2500 and 3500 vehicles, such as the Silverado, Sierra, Yukon XL, Suburban, and Express. It's also available in Workhorse Class A motorhomes, Malibu boats, Mastercraft boats, and a T98 combat armored vehicle. You may have noticed on that list that there are no small cars, and we'll explain why in just a second. The weirdest thing about this engine is that when most people hear the word Vortec, they immediately think of the LS-based 5.3-liter truck engine that pretty much everyone swaps into their cars. The cool thing about the LS-based truck engine is that you can use other LS parts, such as LS-1 heads, for example. Unfortunately, there are a couple things that hold the Vortec 8100 back from ever being as popular as the LS-based Vortec engines. As you can imagine, putting an engine this heavy in a Corvette or Camaro would completely throw off the weight balance and make it really hard to handle properly. Second thing holding this engine back from being popular is availability. Now, the Chevy LS you can find in pretty much any junkyard in the US. Vortec 8100 was not nearly as popular as the LS, so just finding one by itself is kind of hard to do. And then once you do find one, the price may be kind of high because there's not a whole lot of them around. This availability also transfers over to the aftermarket, as the Vortec does not have a very good aftermarket. See, for the LS, there's pretty much anything you want, from swap kits, turbo kits, superchargers, cams, heads, pretty much anything you want aftermarket. Plus, you can use other LS-based parts, such as putting LS-1 heads on a 5.3 truck engine. Unfortunately, the Vortec is not like this, so you can't just take a Vortec 8100 and put LS1 heads on it. It doesn't work that way. If you want better cylinder heads, you have to go aftermarket. If you want a better camshaft, you have to go aftermarket. If you want anything, you pretty much have to go aftermarket. You can't just pick from the pile of GM performance parts out there. Those three things combined really hold the Vortec 8100 back from being popular in the enthusiast community, although there are some hot rodders out there who really like this engine. For the most part, most people would rather just have an LS-based truck engine. When it comes to the aftermarket for the Vortec 8100, there is one really cool company that comes to mind, and that's Raylar Engineering. What they do is they take an already giant 496 cubic inch engine and crank it up to either 511 or 540 cubic inches. They also offer camshafts, cylinder heads, superchargers, and a couple other things for the 8100. Their Stage 3 540 cubic inch kit, for example, takes that 340 horsepower 8100 and cranks it up to 680 horsepower. 685 horsepower for a 540 cubic inch engine really isn't that much, but the thing is, with that stroker kit, it's going to make 680 foot-pounds of torque, which is way more than an LS is going to make naturally aspirated. As we mentioned earlier, the Vortec was supposed to be an alternative to the LB7 Duramax, which was the Duramax that GM used at the time. The 8100 did make more horsepower when it came out, but it didn't have the same amount of torque. The Duramax made 70 foot-pounds of torque more, but it also made that torque at a lower RPM. So if you were really into towing and hauling, the Duramax was still the better option. And that torque gap grows even greater. The farther down the Duramax engine line you go, that torque gap gets even larger and larger, making the Vortec 8100 less and less attractive. To put this all simply, the Vortec 8100 is a good engine, but it's not as good as the Duramax, which ultimately kind of led to it being killed off with the 6-liter LS-based truck engine to fill its shoes. Due to a heavy weight, lack of availability, and a small aftermarket, it's also not very popular in the hot rod community. Although there are a lot of guys who like this engine, and it is gaining momentum. It'll never be as popular as the LS, but it is gaining momentum right now. So, there you have it. That's the quick and short story of the Vortec 8100. Let me know down in the comments below what you guys think of this engine. Be sure to hit that thumbs up button and subscribe, and I'll see you guys in the next one.